Now we're gonna be so on point. we got a chance to get everything out of our systems. 10,000%. We got this. Perfect start. Best episode exactly. of the year coming up.
What's up, guys? Thank you guys so much for joining us again. This is our favorite show of the year. This is our end of year extravaganza. In years past, the way it works is we kind of run down our 10 favorite films of the year. They're not necessarily our, you know, the Oscar picks or the ones we think are going to win the Oscars or what have you. These are just films that we saw at some point of the year that came out in 2020. Like, we saw them in 2020. I don't care about Toronto Film Festival bullshit where it came out 17 months ago or something. If it was not widely released or we couldn't find it or whatever, 2020, that's when we saw it. So the way it works is we each have 10 films that we saw, Mr. Andrew Volpe and myself, and we have 10 films on our lists. If we have a film that is overlapping, for instance, if Showgirls, is it Showgirls? What was your movie last year that you loved?
Showgirls is a Call Girls? Showgirls no, is what a was, movie what? For all seasons, my friend. I think you're well, thinking of a
you fuck, don't know me.
What
dog.
Was it called? The J-Lo movie.
What was the J-Lo movie?
Man, now you're making me forget it. It's Hustlers.
Anyway, Hustlers. Okay, so last year, Hustlers was what, number 8 on your list?
Yeah. And then,
okay, it didn't make my list, believe it or not. But my number one pick last year was,
I believe,
the Oscar-winning film Parasite.
Yes,
and it was, best picture. I think it was number 10 on your list.
I think it was number 9, something okay. like that.
So now, right. So the way it worked is when you introduced it at number 9, hey, Parasite, the best film of the year, the Oscar winner. It's number 9, and then well, that's higher on my list. So let's talk about it at number 1 where it should sit, and then we rolled right into. Call Girls or Hustlers. So we
the masterpiece about Hustlers known as Hustlers. Mm-hmm. Please give it the respect it deserves, David. One day history will smile upon me. You know, people don't understand, but they will one day, years from now. I made the right call.
Well, there you go. So, well, the picks will live in infamy, as we say.
Yeah.
You live by your picks, you die by your picks, oh. And then you know, leave comments below. You know what I mean?
I suspect I will be dying by some picks this year. Because as we said, this is not the best, this is not the worst, this is just shit we like, and please take our opinions with a grain of salt, or at least mine.
Well, there you go. Yeah. So, absolutely. So, to get things started at number 10, will you do me the honors of going first?
Oh,
what is your number 10 favorite movie?
Well, for number 10, I'll have to go with a little film that kind of caught me off guard this year called The Vast of Night.
Okay.
Did you end up checking this out?
I did not see it. Is it on Amazon? I meant to see it, but I didn't get around to it. And I confused it for a long time with Color Out of Space. And then I realized they're two different movies. So I saw one, but not the other.
Oh, well, I mean, I can see that. They're kind of sort of similar. I would say... You know, this is a little bit closer to, it's, you know, very specifically trying to go for a Twilight Zone feel. Like, there's a, like, specific call out to the Twilight Zone in the opening. But it's definitely got some touches of, like, a little bit of Spielberg. And I've heard some people compare it to, like, Robert Altman movies. It's definitely very talky. Like, Close Encounters, if it was way more... long tracking. It was like if Close Encounters was written by Aaron Sorkin. It's a lot of like tracking shots and like long rapid fire exchanges.
Just like tons of like Chris Nolan exposition.
Not even exposition. No. It's probably the opposite of exposition. It's all just character building and kind of mood building, which is kind of the best part of it. Is like it's so dialed into like this very specific time. I can't remember the specific year, but it's like, you know, kind of the bridge between the 40s and the 50s. It's not the Roswell incident, but it's like set around then. And it's, and like the specific technology of the era, like
play is like ham radios or something.
Well,
I remember seeing something,
you know,
with that.
Like the old school operators, like when the operator girls would have to connect you,
like, those plug-in
hello, operator. Can you connect me to number 7? Oh, connecting you to number 7.
How did that shit work?
I literally have no idea. My mom's aunt used to do that, and like it still boggles
switchboards,
my mind.
Right?
Yeah, switchboards.
I was like, I can't imagine doing that.
Well, you know, it's crazy because it's like so much stuff relied on it, and it's easy to neglect that. And that's kind of like where the best parts of this movie come in, because it really does like set up, like, you know, just old school technology, old school reel to reel like recording devices, like all these like factor very heavily into the plot, like radio signals and everything, and just kind of like how it would be living in a small town back then, and just and it's kind of like it's got that kind of throwback simpler times vibe without like putting too fine a point on it. It's like without like rubbing in your face a little too much. There's like one part where I think like a character is like, oh, I was reading in a science magazine that they're going to have little TV screens that you carry around with you that you can use as a ham radio. That like, so there's little points like that I feel like are a little too on the nose with like the, drawing allusions between the past and now and everything. But for the most part, it's in pretty enjoyable. It's a little, you know, depending on your attention span, it might get kind of boring. I think I tried watching it with my brother like earlier on, and he was like, nah, I'm out. Like, where's the fucking aliens? but it's got some good spots in it. I would say, and like, there's some good acting and good moments of tension. I really like the lingo, and it's very much like a vibe and a mood type of movie. I will say, it does drag in a few parts, and I did feel like I kind of wanted a little bit more from the conclusion. It's very interesting, and it's the people that worked on it, the guy that wrote and directed it is Andrew Patterson. It's his first effort ever, so I was very, you know, it's kind of like a good little surprise, and you know, it's on Amazon for free if you got Prime. So I'd say, you know, if you're looking for something a little different, definitely worth your time.
Nice. All right. Well, and I forgot to mention at the top, but basically we're going to try to kind of run through these and not give any spoilers. We are treating this as like movies that we love, that we love this year, that we want to encourage you to go find, assuming that you probably haven't seen all of these. I mean, who has, you know? So that's kind of the whole idea. My number 10 documentaries don't get a whole lot of love. I really enjoyed Belushi by R.J. Cutler. It landed on Showtime in November. It kind of chronicles his life, his death, his career. It has his widow helping to kind of paint the unseen picture of Belushi. I feel like all I knew was Animal House Belushi and like Saturday Night Live Belushi. So it was great to kind of hear her perspective, because she was basically his high school sweetheart, and they basically dated and kind of married and were together throughout his entire, all the ups and downs of his career.
So she, crazy. You know, like, I had no idea that A, she was alive, and B, just the concept of like, you know, it's so crazy that John Belushi, has left such an impact on the world. Even now, like, his shadow hangs over. When did he die? Like 1983, was it?
He died in 82 at the Chateau Marmont.
I mean, that's all.
In Hollywood.
We're damn near 40 years to pass that anniversary. That's so crazy to think that, like, you know, you're with somebody for a, you know, a short period of time, and if they're like taken away like that, that their legend just lives on and on, man. Anyway, sorry, that's a little digression, but like, like Belushi's whole backstory, does it like go into the craziness of like what the SNL, him and all the SNL cast used to do? Or
It goes into kind of his rivalries and him being kind of upset with Lorne Michaels. Lorne Michaels like fired him three different times and he kind of was jealous of the Chevy Chase. Like, Chevy, I didn't really realize, because, you know, obviously this is like, you know, before our time when these shows were premiering live, and they were, it was really painting the picture of like how much of a cultural icon and significance the characters and people would, you know, Chevy Chase became a huge star, and he had his own kind of motto when he signed off on Weekend Update, when he signed off as I'm Chevy Chase and you're not, was his sign off, and it became like this huge thing. And then Chevy Chase kind of left and went off to do bigger, better things or whatever. Belushi kind of stepped in and was able to kind of fill that gap. Now he finally got, you know, some of his skits were getting kind of more involved. It was really interesting. You know, he was kind of the son of an immigrant family, Albanians. His dad wasn't supportive of him at all. Wasn't, you know, his dad was a restaurant guy who just wanted to, you know, put your nose down, grind,
get your
just
ass work in the hard kitchen
in silence.
Yeah, yeah, do your thing.
You know, just his widow, Judy, shared a lot of his letters because they were living apart for a big portions of his life. He was traveling, or he's like filming things or whatever.
Yeah.
But even that, like, I think he wrote her a lot of kind of letters, and especially when they were kind of on the outs, there were times when they weren't really doing well, and there were days that he would just kind of leave. He would just leave even when they were living together in New York. He would just take off and go do drugs and go on benders and shit. So he has a lot of letters of like spilling his guts to her and trying to patch things up and explaining that he's a piece of shit and I'm insecure and, you know, I love you and you're the only thing that matters in my life. Like, I know I need to fix this or whatever. It kind of goes into his death. You know, he got, you know, a woman facilitated his death. I don't know if she's really to blame, but basically this woman overdosed him by injecting him. And it was a whole, you know, whole drama. So, you know, she fled to Canada and then kind of got deported back and then died at the Hotel Marmont, which was weird. I got to stay there once and, you know, ran into a few different weird people. It's like a celebrity hotel that has actual celebrities. Like, if you just go hang out in the lobby, you'll see people. Like, I ran into Hillary Swank. Hillary Swank is coming out of the hotel as I was walking in, and it was that classic, I look at her, I recognize immediately, oh wow, it's Hillary Swank. She sees me, seeing her, and the look on her face, like, was just no. Don't fucking.
Please
look.
Don't.
Please don't look at. Don't. Just whatever you're thinking. She just thought 100% this asshole is going to stop me for a picture or whatever, or to talk to me or something. And I've worked in a bar long enough to know that female look of do not approach me. Do not talk to me. Just
not
from
today,
seeing her.
Not today.
From afar. Not today. Not ever. Great little movie. If you have Showtime, what is your number 9?
Let me see the list. Okay, my number 9 is a cool little indie movie called The Assistant.
Okay.
On Hulu now, actually, I think I saw it as like one of those deals. I keep on being the one asshole who like rents the movie and like finding out like a week later. It's like Hulu like waits to see when I rent something just so I can like put it on a week later just to spite me.
Yeah, Hollywood thanks you for your contribution.
Whatever, man. I gotta support the industry. This movie stars Julia Gardner, who I am not familiar with. I don't watch Ozark, but I hear she is a big part of Ozark, and
she's great. Yeah,
it sounds like she's playing a very different character on Ozark because she's like loud and cusses a lot, something like that.
Yeah, in Ozark, she's
like a redneck,
very loud. Yeah. She lives with her family's like pretty poor, lives in, you know, kind of like trailers that are like parked in a clearing by a lake. Uh-huh. Criminal elements in her family. So she's it's an awesome character. But yeah, I think I remember her from like Electric Children, I think was the first thing I saw.
Yeah, that's a
her in or whatever
poster I've seen on Netflix like over and over and never gotten around to seeing.
Yep. It's got one of the Culkins in it. I can't remember which one. It's not Macaulay, but yeah.
Nice. Well, so it sounds like.
So this is the Harvey Weinstein movie,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, this is basically what it is. It's so Julia Gardner's her character, and this sounds like polar opposite of whatever she plays in Ozark. But yeah, it's basically a Harvey Weinstein movie, but it's like another good tone movie. It's done very, very subtly and kind of just like has a delicate touch to it. It's is directed by I think a first time director named Kitty Green, and I think she apparently was a documentary filmmaker, and this is her first like fiction feature, so it's kind of got like most of the scenes kind of have that fly on the wall feel, and it's one of those movies where it's like kind of like you just see scenes play out, and it's kind of more about like what's not being said than what is. And it's basically she's this young girl who's a intern or an assistant at this big movie studio that's for a producer that's basically Harvey Weinstein. They never come out and say it, but it's clearly has all the same trapping. The thing that's cool about it is like you know, most movies, you think of like movie studios, you think of like Hollywood lots, and you usually think of it more of as a West Coast thing, and like the fact that it's just like set in like a cold New York kind of crowded, you know, just regular office building kind of like it feels very realistic. And it's all just takes place over one day. Like, and it's all just like basically follows her as she goes about her daily chores of the day. And the cool thing is it's like a lot of mundane shit. It's all her like, you know, getting people coffee and making sure that she's got the right people's resumes photocopied. And one of the first things you see her do is like when she comes in the office at 5 a.m, she's got to go into the producer's office to scrub the jizz out of the couch and everything like that. But that's mixed in with the coffee and everything like that. And the fact that it's all done with just like the same nonchalance is very cool. And you kind of just get a look into her character too. Like she's like she has to say a lot without saying things, so it's like she's very clearly conflicted about this job and she's very alone. And it just, for anyone that's had shitty intern jobs, this definitely kind of I feel like will speak to you a little bit, especially New York internship. I feel like that's a specific thing all into itself and everything. So not like anything super thrillery or whatever, but it's very unique.
Nice. All right, I'm going Freaky. Oh, at number 9.
Nice, good pick.
It's got just the classic Vince Vaughn, the Vince Vaughn of yesteryear. You know, I like the Cell Block Vince Vaughn. I like the Dragged Across Concrete Vince Vaughn, but it was good to just see him kind of get back into kind of like a little bit more fun comedic role. Basically it's another kind of Chris Landon. Like he did like Paranormal Activity, he did a couple of the sequels, and then he did like Happy Death Day, and he seems to be good at kind of like finding some weird trope and then kind of like turning it on its head a mm-hmm. little bit with like a little horror element. And then it's basically, it's, you know, Vince Vaughn plays a serial killer, and then there's a girl who, you know, is the stereotypical hot ugly girl in high school. So she basically happens and they get their bodies switched.
Yeah, it's like definitely seems like it's got the she doesn't wear glasses, but it's practically that sort of thing where it's like, oh, as soon as she takes off her glasses, everyone realizes she's gorgeous, you know.
They literally have a scene like she's going through high school and she's tortured, and everyone's so mean to her, and the other hot girls are mean to her, and, you know, make fun of her clothes, and they literally like pull her hair in a ponytail, I think maybe put red lipstick on her, and then have her wear a pair of jeans, and then she just walks in, and it's just that classic scene of the high school hallway of every just every dude breaking his neck, turning around, and
the guy, you know, lowering his sunglasses like, as he walks by or something right. like that.
It's just and I love this movie because of how bad a lot of the 16 candles-ness of kind of mm-hmm. things, you know, just how bad, like, you know, they have Vince Vaughn as like living in some sort of, you know, it looks like a dungeon / burnt out, you know, factory.
It's a little bit of a crack
warehouse thing.
But it had some like
it's basically a crack.
It had some weird, like, I don't know, like 90s, like Nine Inch Nails video looking shit. And totally. Like skulls.
It looks like a Tool music video or something. Yeah. And it's like, this is just not how serial killers live in real life. Live like that's how they don't get caught.
Yeah, like this,
you know what I mean, like they're normal enough.
Yeah,
that's the whole thing.
Yeah, I did definitely wonder like what was Vince Vaughn's character like, you know, before the body switch, because I was just like, wait a minute, he's a serial killer, but he's like, I think they were going for a Jason thing, but he seems more kind of like the Michael Myers thing where it's like,
yeah, they just, yeah, and you see more of that through the girl, Millie Kessler is the actress, but basically the way she acts as the serial killer mm-hmm. helps you kind of figure out like, oh, this is not a genius. This is not a personable. It's not a BTK. It's not, it's not someone who,
this is just flatline sociopath, like need to stab everything. Yeah,
it's just a Ramirez Boston Strangler maybe or something. Mm-hmm, I don't know, but you know, it's a fun little movie. It makes fun of all the high school stuff. The friends are fun. It's a fun little movie. We needed one.
But yeah, for my number 8, I had Tenet, that little movie that I don't think anyone...
I have not heard of
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah. Wasn't it supposed to save something? You remember...
Save Hollywood, save
movies,
humanity.
Movies, those things we used to see. You know, this movie, I feel like it was such a big, weird thing this year, and it wasn't... I definitely won't come out and say it's a perfect movie. Like, I won't be like a hardcore defender of this movie. I definitely understand people who like fault this movie for saying it's basically 2.5 hours of robot people spouting exposition and then confusing action scenes. But even though I think the movie like kind of almost barely works as a movie, I think it's almost not really intended to function as a movie for the most part, for better or worse. Like, the concept behind it is really cool in some ways, even though it's kind of goofy and it doesn't totally make sense, but I can't argue that I've never seen anything like that before. Like it is something that's totally different than I've seen before. And I think even though a lot of the actors are given not much to work with, I think there's a lot of really good actors there, like kind of try to do their best with the material they're given. And really the big thing was any movie that like basically sends me down those YouTube rabbit holes, listening to physics, you know, interviews with physicists, like about the science of these weird sci-fi plots, is enough to like make me say it was worth the price of admission. And I'm not Christopher Nolan's best, but I think it's like actually a commendable one. And, yeah, it's definitely worth a watch.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about it months and months. I think during the summer or something, we talked about it briefly, and you had seen it, and I hadn't yet seen it. And now that I've seen it, I don't know. I feel like he's on a racetrack, and everyone else is driving like Mazda Miatas and has to make and he's got a fucking Ferrari or something. You know what I mean? So like. Yeah. If you have the budget to fly planes, that they bought a plane and then they just drove it into a building,
right?
Kind of for the scene of it, like, and then to kind of make a movie that just so many people are going to be kind of confused by, it just seems so weird. Like, right. If you're going to go for the Michael Bay just giant plane explosion angle of like, I need a movie that's going to save the industry because it's so awesome, but then he made it so incredibly non-basic enough to basically follow. Well, like, I mean, I'm sitting there watching, like, I don't understand, like, who is this made for? Well, it's not like a
I do feel like the whole thing with, like, you know, on top of Christopher Nolan's whole like, oh, I gotta save cinema because that's my like whole thing, but like I feel like this movie in particular, like watching it a second time now, was like very clearly geared, there's a lot of like subtext in there that feels like it's geared towards like, oh, this is cinema, like the look how big the screen is, like it opens with a theater that like look like, you know, people are watching an orchestra, but the orchestra theater looks exactly like an IMAX theater. And I feel like them using an orchestra is like him saying like, oh, you're like, this is going to be my symphony. And there's all sorts of little nods to things like that. But I feel like you do kind of lose something like not seeing it in that big theater experience. But I feel like beyond all of that, there isn't as much there. Like, I think it's like, oh, here's a weird idea with some really cool action sequences and like weird things you've never seen before. But yeah, you know, once you get to the emotional part, like, you know, I could give two shits about most of the characters in it. You know what I mean? Like, it is something about Christopher Nolan, you know, like whenever he has a flaw, he'll like double down on it. So it's like, can't hear the audio. Fuck you. It's going to be inaudible. Like, you don't think my characters are two-dimensional, fuck you, they're gonna be one-dimensional in this movie. You know,
well, that's the whole thing. It's a joke now. Everyone's like, oh, you gotta watch with subtitles on, make sure your subtitles are on.
Truly, the subtitles made the biggest difference in the world. Like, I appreciated so many, I know like people make jokes about it, but I was like, oh, that makes so much more sense. Like, they have so many things in this movie that they just kind of toss off in one like literally one line that like has so many implications that, like, yeah, I'm sorry, bro, like, I get, like, impressionistic, whatever, filmmaking, that's cool if your movies aren't fucking just super duper dense and everything. I don't get the way he thinks sometimes. But anyway, so, yeah, because of conversations like this, that's why I liked it this year, because it just makes for interesting dialogue between people.
Yeah, I'm thankful that we at least got to kind of see it. It's a fun movie. It's weirdly confusing. It's almost irritating in a way of how like non-linear, but it's standard Chris Nolan. At least it looks cool.
Yeah,
it is what it is. But could have been better, probably. It could have sounded better, sure. Could they have written a female lead or a female character that doesn't sound horrible and unlikable? Yes, I mean, they could have done a few different things. But you know, maybe next time. I think Chris Nolan's got to go back to do some interesting, fun, big, not necessarily a Batman or something, but maybe. Maybe a non-original concept to kind of get the groove back and earn back some money for Warner Brothers if he ever works for them again.
Yeah. Do Godzilla versus King Kong 2. Christopher Nolan's Godzilla versus King Kong.
I'd watch it.
Yeah.
All right. So moving along. My number eight, Uncle Frank, directed by Alan Ball. Famously wrote American Beauty, won the Oscar for that, worked on stuff like 6 Feet Under. He's the creator of 6 Feet Under. He created True Blood, even though I know True Blood's like based on books, but he created the show. Uh-huh. Worked on like Banshee. Stars Paul Bettany. He was like a producer. I don't know how much he wrote Banshee, but yeah, you know, Paul Bettany's in this. The girl who is Beverly Marsh in the It movies, Sophia Lillis. Judy Greer is in this as like a horrible accent redneck southerner, along with Steve Zahn.
Wait, is this like Georgia South? Where did you say this was again?
Georgia. I think Georgia. I want to say Georgia. God, I'm trying to remember. I can't remember. It's one of the. It's cartoonishly South. You know what I mean? Okay, you can just basically.
This doesn't exist in the real
it could
world.
Be this any is, of them.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's great. It's I think that, you know, Peter MacDissey, who I think was in 6 Feet Under, plays Wally, who is kind of Paul Bettany's love interest, longtime partner, and he's great. He kind of stole the whole movie. But basically, it's about Sophia Lillis. Beth is her character. She is kind of the only one in her southern family that kind of clicks with her uncle. She's not really sure why, but they kind of share similar sensibilities. Paul Bettany is a college professor at NYU College. I think he's a literature professor. So she goes to NYU, hangs out a little bit, and kind of stumbles into a, you know, I'm trying to remember the setup, but basically discovers that he's gay by, you know, coming to a party that, you know, was being thrown kind of at his apartment or something like that. And anyway, so his dad dies kind of suddenly, a little bit elderly. And then so they, you know, they kind of, since they're both in New York together, they kind of carpool and head back down south to go to the funeral. Wally, Paul Bettany's husband, boyfriend, you know, at the time, this is kind of a period piece. It's kind of set in the late 70s, I think. So obviously not the most... you know, comfortable time probably for his lifestyle. So he's kind of dreading having to go back, seeing his family again. And, you know, the kind of the whole fallout of, you know, being worried about how his family might take things. And I don't want to get into the third act or anything, but it's interesting. It's got a lot of awesome performances, I think, from especially Paul Bettany, but I think Peter MacDessy, really good. If this film had gotten more attention, I think he could have gotten into that supporting actor talk. But very, very cool little fun movie. It's a little heavy at times. It's kind of a heavy subject matter, a lot of family drama kind of stuff like that, but definitely worth checking out if you have Amazon Prime. It's
do it, man. Yeah, I've been seeing ads for that everywhere, and I keep on meaning, you know, that's on my ever-growing list of like, oh yeah, that looked cool, I'll get to it eventually, and I just totally forget. But maybe I'll check it out now that it made your list. Well, cool.
So what are you at, 7?
Yeah, so for number 7, I got... I don't know if it's... I think it's just called The Beastie Boys Story, or it's whatever that Beastie Boys documentary that's on Apple TV Plus now is called. It's like the best thing that they've made or bought or whatever, in my opinion. It's this... you know, also, there was a lot of competition for documentaries this year. There was like a lot of pretty decent documentaries, and I figured I would have one on this list at least. Like, I feel like I got to have at least one. But
how many did you see?
How many? I can go through them real quick. I think I saw like 6, 7, something. You know, I saw the octopus one. I saw the
Wow. Yeah, I missed that one.
I saw the what is it, the frog meme one. I saw the
did you see the David Attenborough or whatever?
I don't think I had that level. That's actually on my list, but I wasn't ready to be that depressed quite yet.
Yeah, not yet. Yeah, maybe later.
But yeah, so there was a lot of good stuff, but I feel like the one that hit me in the heartstrings the most was this Beastie Boys movie. And also, you know, like on top of the fact that the Beastie Boys are, you know, I feel like most people are big, you know, Beastie Boys is one of those bands that I feel like most people can dig or get around. Like, I feel like I don't see too many people that are like, fuck the Beastie Boys. But even if you have that opinion, I feel like this movie would really make you appreciate them. It's basically, it's like, it's weird because it's not even like a documentary. It's basically the two surviving Beastie Boys standing in front of a live audience with like a projector screen behind them. I think they filmed like a few live performances like over a few weekends. It was a very limited like showing of it. And yeah, I guess they stitch together a bunch of these live performances, and then they'll, you know, go into the B-roll with all the stuff that they have on their projectors, which are, you know, really, really great, like photos from like family photos, photos from their past, photos from like when they're all just hanging out, and like, you know, music videos, behind the scenes interviews, like all this super old, like early days MTV stuff. And it's just really interesting, and it's really makes you appreciate like where they came from, like the craziness of like, wow, they were like 16 and stuff when they were starting to record with like true hip hop legends. Like, and then they started out as some kind of like jokey band, and like they totally reinvented themselves several times over to become like actual artists. And just kind of by default, it's kind of like the movie kind of becomes a tribute to Adam Yauch, who's MCA, who really, I didn't know this beforehand, but it becomes apparent that he really was the heart and soul of the Beastie Boys. Like, he was the main guy just pushing them artistically, and kind of the guy that brought them together in the first place. And he's kind of like the dude that you could tell was always on the next level. So the fact that he's not there while the other two are talking about him, and you know, you see him like get choked up on stage, and also just the fact that like you're seeing these guys who are like, they're old, man. Like, they're, you know, you can't hide the fact that they are like grandpa level.
Yeah, they've been vegan for 30 years and they're just skin and bones now.
But, you know, but when you have like the pictures of them, like, yeah, looking like Skeletor or whatever next to them when they were 16, and they literally are unrecognizable. Like, I still couldn't tell who was who sometimes because they look so different from how they are now. Again, just really, really interesting. I highly recommend it. I feel like even if you don't like documentaries, people would dig this. So I think it's called The Beastie Boys Story, but it's you know, check it out on Apple TV Plus if you have it.
I don't have Apple TV Plus, but it will be found.
Yeah, one way or another, it'll come to me.
Exactly. All right, my number 7, it is The Color Out of Space. Hell, starring the one and only Nicolas Cage, the Tiger King himself. It is based on the Lovecraft story by the same name, Color Out of Space. It is the reemergence, I guess you will say, I don't know, of Richard Stanley. I know you're long a big dormant fan of. You've seen his early movies. I have not. I have not seen. Is it Hardcore?
All two of them. Yeah, it's like one of them is Hardcore and one of them is Dust Devil. And they're, you know, they're both, they showed a lot of potential. And then, you know, story goes that Island of Dr. Moreau just totally ruined his career.
Okay, so the story is he's kind of this, at the time, this is early 90s, right? Mm-hmm. He's kind of a young and up and coming director. He's from South Africa. He does these two little movies. They probably were like stylish and weird and kooky enough that like someone in Hollywood was like, ooh, shit, get this guy involved. He gets hired to direct The Island of Dr. Moreau, the one that came out like the mid 90s, right? Mm-hmm. And he had some insane fallout with Marlon Brando, and then basically was fired because he couldn't get along with Brando's demands or something, well,
it,
right?
It wasn't so much Brando. Brando was actually kind of in his corner, but the guy that sounds like a real piece of shit was Val Kilmer. Yeah, there's this documentary. I can't remember the exact title, but it's like The Curse of Richard Stanley, something, something. But yeah, like it goes even deeper than that because the movie was like, it was one of those movies where they filmed it in, it was like Australia or New Zealand or someplace far away and exotic, but it got hit by typhoon. So like they had to rebuild the set twice and then people kept on dropping out. So it was supposed to be a 3-month shoot, but it ended up being like a 12-month shoot. And like all of your extras were like, you know, they're supposed to be like monstrous freaks in animal costumes. So you had to keep all those people in hotels for like months and months and months. And they, they fired this so they fired Richard Stanley. And Richard Stanley, like, was practicing witchcraft or something like that at that point. So he put a curse on the production. And then they bought him a ticket to fly home and he never took it. And he actually snuck into the set wearing a dog mask as an extra and he spied on the production. And so he was like freaking them out. They thought he was going to like burn down the set because the rumors were starting to circulate like, oh my God, the old director is still among us. And it's all this other crazy shit. It's just like, it's one of those things where the documentary on it is like far more interesting than probably the final product ever would have been.
I kind of find that way with like, is it Heart of Darkness? Or what is
Hearts of Darkness?
The Ford Coppola one?
Yeah, the
that Apocalypse one, that's great.
Yeah, that's like one of the best documentaries ever. And this is kind of has little echoes of that. Because it's one of those things where like you have a bunch of people on a production like way far away from civilization. And then like people start to go
tropical
all primal.
Bugs.
It's just like, it's very Lord of the Flies or something.
Nice. Well, yeah, this is, you know, kind of his first movie in a couple of years, right? And, you know, it's basically about a family that definitely kind of like an upper class family from, I think, New York. Mm-hmm. And they kind of move to, I don't know if it's Catskills or something. They kind of move to the country. They're raising like alpacas or something on like a little bit of a farm ranch type thing. You know, the mom is still working with like finance clients over Skype and whatever. So, Nicolas Cage is just kind of like a family man kind of style. You know what I mean? He's overacting a little bit, but, a weird, mysterious rock meteorite, what have you, kind of crashes, you know, on their property and it just starts affecting everything. You know, the family, the family starts changing and becoming irritable and kind of crazy. The animals start acting weird, like, and you know, it just, it has some of the freakiest body horror elements of stuff there, as things start
there's some
like
images.
The thing style, you know what I mean?
Believe me, if you never thought about alpacas and how creepy they can be, you will. And just and also this is a H.P. Lovecraft story, right? So it's all deep into that flavor of just kind of grossness. But yeah, I mean, talk about a match made in heaven. Like, I feel like Nicolas Cage is just like right at home in this material, right? Like,
yeah, it's not quite it's not Mandy levels of an unhinged, but it's perfect for him because he has to play at times a reasonable, normal person. That's how he is in the beginning before things start to unravel. And then there's kind of a gradual escalation of him being incredibly emotional and loud and screaming and things like that. So it's perfect for him because, you know, give me like an 8.
Yeah.
Give me like an 8 out of 10. And he's good.
He can't go full Mandy all the time. I feel like he'll burn himself out.
He's going to hurt himself.
Also, like, I feel like it's like, it's a little bit more compelling when you don't cast Nicolas Cage these days unless you're having him do something crazy. So it would be nice if the craziness is like some sort of factor of the plot. Like it actually is like, you know, supposed to be there instead of like just Nicolas Cage. Like you just like let Nicolas Cage ad lib some crazy bullshit, you know, like for instance, Mandy was like a, you know, it was a great movie and I understood why they had him kind of go crazy. But like the selling point of that movie was, oh, here's like, you know, 45 minutes of Nicolas Cage going crazy, you know?
The bathroom scene, yeah, and you know, yeah, all, but basically the color out of space, it's purple, it's like magenta. That's not really a spoiler, but you know, I think they were talking about how Lovecraft, it was like trying to describe a color that doesn't exist in the spectrum. Basically, it's just purple. It's basically
but
it's magenta.
Purple is that flavor of purple, I feel like, is like used, you know, if you're going for something cosmic or astral or whatever, like that's you know, what are you gonna do, figure out another color on the spectrum or whatever?
Well, there you go. We're not out here inventing colors, yeah, and we wouldn't ask you know, Richard Stanley to have to do that. But yeah, it's great. The actress in it is she actually, I didn't think of this, I didn't know if this was a connection, but I think it's like Madeline Arthur. She plays Lavinia.
Oh yeah,
Lavinia,
yeah.
And she's a practicing Wiccan in the movie.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So
that's totally,
I don't know if that was part, that's totally like a Richard Stanley,
I feel like,
injection.
Yeah, like that was,
it's not part of the original source material.
Didn't it feel kind of random otherwise? Like it felt like,
yeah,
we already got this, you know, this weird shit. But yeah, I could be.
That was a three on the scale of what the fuck was that? That you're gonna run
all
into.
All the other crazy shit made me quickly forget about that.
Yeah, having your teenage daughter being into witchcraft is like one of the least shocking, weird things in that film.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
go check it out.
Yeah, yeah. So my number six is a movie called The Nest. Yeah,
okay.
I don't know if you like, did you hear of this movie? Like, I
heard of it because I think I saw, is it on HBO Max?
Oh, is it? Oh, God. Because
I've scrolled through and I think I confused it with whatever Jude Law's TV show on HBO Max is. It's called like The Third Day.
Oh, yes, you're right. That is a
Those
is
were
a
his
show,
two big,
I think,
projects this year. So I think I'm confusing that. But yeah, The Nest with... And has Jude.
Yeah, like, right? That's awesome. I basically, like, Jude Law is like one of those actors that I kind of like undercut. Like, I kind of like, it's like one of those things where it's like you don't see one of their works in a while and you kind of like forget, like, oh, they can be really good actors. But yeah, he's really good in this. And the other lead is Carrie Coon, who is, you know, I never watched The Leftovers and I did not see season 3 of Fargo, so that's the two, you know, big things I feel like everyone always brings up when they talk about her. But man, she's a fantastic actress. I hadn't actually seen a trailer for this. I hadn't heard of this until it popped up as a review on one of the review shows I usually like to listen to. So I like stopped it before I could listen to it, and I just kept on hearing like, hey, this is a movie you should just go into blind, don't see a trailer, don't even read the plot synopsis. So I went into this totally blind, and it was, I don't know how much that affected my experience of watching the movie, but it was really, really cool. Like, the entire time, like, it's so rare I've had an experience where I watch a movie and I'm like, I literally don't know, like an hour into the movie, I'm like, I don't know what the fuck I'm watching. I don't know. Like, and it literally, like, I was like, is this movie gonna be like Kill List and it's gonna turn into a horror movie all of a sudden? Like, are there gonna be vampires, or is this gonna be a crime movie, or is this gonna be like Hereditary, or is this gonna, and I would say tamper your expectations a little bit, like, you know, like maybe I was like thinking a little too far outside the box, but like the entire time, the main point was, like, despite all that, like, I was still riveted because I was so invested in this family. And it's the entire thing is just like, it's like kind of like a family drama. It's about a well-to-do family in the 80s. The dad's like a stockbroker or something, and the dad basically forces the family to move to England, and things don't seem to be as good as he makes them out to be, and the family kind of each seems to be having their own individual issues, and it just kind of keeps on ratcheting up tension. It's really hard to describe. You kind of just have to watch it. It's got like this weird hypnotic kind of feel to it. Like, scenes just play out and you're unnerved and you're not sure why. There's the, like, all this stuff with Carrie Coon takes care of a horse, and like, the horse doesn't seem to be doing well, and there's this, like, just these scenes of a horse whinnying that's just very weirdly tense. So, yeah, I really recommend it. You know, it'll probably pop up on Amazon Prime or something, or HBO Max. And whenever it does, it's a good movie to just kind of give a shot. Cause, you know, you kind of have to like sit with it and pay attention to it and like, appreciate the characters, but it's a good character study. And it's from Sean Durkin, who did, you know, Marcy May Marlene a few years ago. So, if you like that, you might dig this.
Sounds good. Where? I'm sold.
Yep.
We'll check it out.
So what's your right. number five? Is that where we're on?
I think I'm on six.
Oh, six. Sorry about that.
Yeah, yeah. So my number six, something we talked about earlier in the year, we both liked it, Sputnik, which you can see on Hulu now finally.
Whew.
So fun little movie. It's basically like a very creepy, you know, the director, I'm trying to, Igor Abramenko. Very young guy, you know, he made a short film kind of as a proof of concept of this a few years ago. And then, you know, that kind of sold people to let him kind of make a full length feature for this. But his inspiration was basically, he's a Russian director, obviously it's a Russian film. But he kind of wanted to make creepy 80s USSR with aliens. So that's just a match made in heaven. You know what I mean? As like, what would happen if there was an alien incident among perestroika Russian, the fall of the Soviet Union, like how would that work? How would they study it? How would they kind of go about it? So it's basically about, you know, just to be very, very kind of vague with the plot. It's, you know, there's a Russian cosmonaut who is up with another cosmonaut orbiting the Earth's orbit, obviously, you know what I mean, in a capsule. And you're like, and we talked about this in the review, the Russia factor in this film looms large, where it's impossible to tell what year it is, because you don't know if it's 1950 or 1989, because it's so Russia.
Mm-hmm.
And and we got yelled at because we didn't know what Sputnik actually stands for, companion, but someone was very angry that we didn't know that. Sorry, bro. We don't speak Russian. You know what I mean? I assumed it was a reference to the famous satellite that first orbited the Earth, but what have you. But it's great. I mean, it's...
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's totally, like, I mean, I feel like them saying, you know, if they're trying to go for that, like, 79 alien, like, Ridley Scott alien feel, like, even though it's, like, you know, most of the movie's set on Earth... Like, it definitely has that vibe. And, you know, I guess it kind of reminded me a little bit of the Chernobyl thing that was on HBO last year. Uh-huh. Just because, you know, like you were saying, all the Russia stuff all around, it's especially that kind of whatever, like, 60s to 80s bracket of Russian, you know, aesthetics and everything like that. It's definitely, like, fully in there. But yeah, it totally has that old school alien vibe. And it's such a good... just like, it's so tense sometimes, man.
It's super atmospheric, it's super creepy, it's kind of, it reminds me of elements of Alien, where it's spread out through the different films of, there's an overarching either company, I mean it's the Wayland company basically in Alien, where, you know, they at all costs, they really want it, they don't care about the people involved or how many people die or how many, you know, how many soldiers might die or how many, you know, whatever it is, employees of the company, right? It's like there's this weird, you know, and this one is just the Russian government, you know what I mean? But I'd love that creepy,
the faceless entity.
We need to
understand
how to weaponize
the thing is more important than, you know, we'll throw however many men at this thing until we figure out how to make it kill people or whatever, you know?
Right. Just trying to weaponize it, basically. Yeah. So it's great. It's on Hulu if you give it a shot. It's horror-ish. Just...
Yeah.
It's kind of... It's not super scary. It's not... It's on par with, like, an Aliens.
Yeah, it's more things... Yeah, think Alien 1, not Alien 5 or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, like, it's very...
Which one was Alien 5? Resurrection? Or is that the fourth one?
Yeah, actually, that's a bad one. Okay, so Alien... Not Alien 2. Not Aliens. Alien, not Aliens. How's that?
Okay. I think Alien is scarier than this. I think it's almost... It's Alien is...
Yeah, I mean, Alien is one
legit
of the best.
Scary.
Yeah, true.
Check it out, people. All right, what's your number five?
My number five is, just saw this the other day, and it was kind of like a late addition, but screw it. It's the new Pixar movie Soul, which, you know, caught...
I have heard of it.
Yeah, caught it, you know, purely because I, much like my Apple Plus account, I have a Disney Plus account that I only have because I got it for free for a year, and I figured I should use it. So... yeah, you know, I just threw it on the other day. I watched it with my brother, who's a musician. So we both enjoyed it. I kind of missed out on the last few Pixar movies. So I don't know. Like, I've always kind of like associated them with like a high pedigree. I kind of feel like, you know, the Disney forcing endless sequels upon them has tarnished that a lot. Oh, not a lot. A little bit, though. You know, the cars and all that stuff. So I've kind of missed out on a lot of the sequels, except for Toy Story movies. And I missed out on kind of their, like, what was the last one? I think the last one I saw was Inside Out. And then, like, I missed out on Coco and a few more since then. Yeah, so this was very cool. Like, the other thing was I went in Unsullied to this one, too. So I've kind of been off the internet lately. I didn't see the trailer for and everything, so I had no idea what to expect for this one. I just knew it was about like jazz kind of tangentially, and that probably helped my experience a lot because it goes in very random directions. You know, I think the plot synopsis is basically there's a musician, you know, a music teacher played by Jamie Foxx, who's kind of in a lackluster career. He's like teaching, but he wants to be a musician, and he finally gets a gig of his lifetime with this famous jazz musician, and he's supposed to play that night, and then something happens where, well, he falls through a manhole and goes to the afterlife, and basically the whole thing is him trying to get back to his body in time to make this gig to kind of give his life purpose. And you know, true to Pixar's kind of you know, reputation, this one definitely goes through the gut punch of like some would argue overly heady and depressing ideas for a kid's movie, but I kind of like that they throw that in there, like, you know, particularly in the, like, what have I done with my life kind of feel. You know, they definitely, like, try to, I like the way they imagine whatever their afterlife is, but, you know, they definitely don't, they try to very much make it their own. They're not trying to like tie this to any specific religion or anything like this. They make it very clear, like, oh, these are all abstractions, and, you know, anything can happen here. This is just like a visual representation of a very abstract concept. But, you know, voice cast is pretty good. I really like, I always mispronounce his last name, but the guy from the IT Crowd, Richard Ayoade.
Is he the voice of the character that's like running around, like the accountant character?
He's not the accountant guy, but basically there's like the closest thing I can explain them is they're basically like angels. Like, they're the people that run the afterlife, and they're designed to look like cubist, like Picasso faces. And I love their design. They're like one of the things that I like, but yeah, he's one of them. And yeah, he's very like prim and proper and British. I think a lot of them are British for some reason. And then they have,
well, that's how God talks.
Yeah. Of course, yeah. You know, British,
in a British accent.
It's either Nazis or angels, you know. You never know why. But yes, it's a really cool movie, explored some interesting themes, and, you know, I'm always kind of ready to like be over Pixar, but you know, when they do stuff like this, I'm kind of intrigued. So it might be I just needed a nice little animated movie to throw on my list this year, but I definitely enjoyed it. And if you got Disney Plus, just throw it on for free if you're bored.
I gotta finish it. I'm only halfway through, so it will be finished.
Good one to fall asleep to or something.
Yeah. All right. My number five, On the Rocks, Sofia Coppola, Woo. Bill Murray, Marlon Wayans, Rashida Jones. It's like a alternate Rick and Morty dimension where Bill Murray just has a family, kind of like basically he just has a daughter, but he basically kind of plays an older playboy type. You know, Rashida Jones is his daughter. His daughter is worried that, you know, her husband is kind of, might be cheating on her. She's kind of insecure and worried that he's getting too friendly with kind of the hot executive at his work, played by Jessica Henwick, the from like Iron Fist and I feel like she's popping up in a few more things nowadays, but she's kind of like, you know, the hot young, it's like a social media company. So everyone who works there is like 23 years old and they're all, you know, good looking in New York. And she's like 38 and she's, you know, there's a scene where there's kind of a work event and it's like a party and she's there and she kind of can't really connect with anyone. She doesn't have anything in common. So she kind of, that just kind of increases the levels of like, oh fuck, oh shit, oh, you know. So she kind of reveals how she feels to Bill Murray, her father, and Bill Murray, who is kind of a scumbag himself. Mm-hmm. I'll leave it at that, but he's kind of, he's, you know, takes one to know one kind of a thing. So he's immediately kind of like, yep, that's suspicious. Yep. That's a sign. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep. So the whole movie is basically, he's kind of a wealthy, it's basically Bill Murray, right? So like if Bill Murray was just a rich guy, which Bill Murray is a rich guy, he would do eccentric things like get out of tickets with cops and take over a room and charm like a whole, like, you know, run into like old flings and stuff like randomly. And he's like an art dealer. So, you know, he's just always prowling and stuff like that. But it's great. It's really just Bill Murray in a parallel universe playing Bill Murray. So that's pretty much what I enjoyed about it. I think it's a cute movie. It's better. It's like less brutal than a standard Sofia Coppola movie to me. You know what I mean? It's a little bit more fun in a way, even though the subject matter is kind of heavy. You know what I mean? Where like, you know,
well, like I feel like of all the movies, and you know, granted, I haven't seen all of her movies, but like, I feel like of all the ones that I've seen, this one is like, feels the most specifically trying to call out to that Lost in Translation feeling. Like, it feels like a companion piece to Lost in Translation, you know, more than just the Bill Murray factor. Like, I think the fact that he is a central character to both of them is it, but they're both kind of about, like, women at, like, kind of turning points in their life where they're not sure about their significant other, and they gotta kind of turn to Bill Murray for help, and, like, it's kind of like Japan is this exotic place, you know, that this young woman seeing at this younger time in her life. And now it's kind of about an older woman at home kind of coming to terms with home life and, you know, just dissatisfaction that comes with age and everything like that. So, I thought it's like, I think that fact made it a little bit more interesting than some of the other things that I've seen her do. And just like, yeah, having Bill Murray, man, is like, you know, he makes any scene like magic. And just yeah, him talking himself out of that ticket in that one scene is friggin' fantastic.
So it sounds like she, you know, Sofia Coppola, it sounds like she drew a lot of inspiration from about her father. I mean, she's obviously got a very famous father, a well-known father, Francis Ford Coppola. And she definitely borrowed traits of his and injected them into that character. And then Bill Murray kind of picked up the slack and like made it his own. Mm-hmm. But
I'm sure there's a lot of Murray in there.
Yeah. I think, you know, I'd be curious to see like what is on the script and then what did Bill Murray just do?
Yeah,
you know what
yeah.
I mean? Because I can't imagine trying to write Bill Murray.
Oh, yeah. I feel like it. And I feel like, especially, like, I feel like maybe Coppola likes to do a little bit more kind of improv-y stuff, at least with him. Like, I feel like she knows enough. Like, the best people that seem to work the best with Bill Murray are the ones that know when to kind of just, like, let him run with stuff, you know what I mean? Jarmusch and, you know, Anderson and all those people. Like, they always seem to, like, kind of know how far to push him and like kind of just when to let the camera roll and kind of let him ad lib and do his thing or whatever. So I'm glad that he's got some space to play in this one. And yeah, I mean, he's still got it too. Like, I love that it hasn't like faded his Bill Murray-ness. Like, he's still one of the most charming people alive.
Yeah. And that's definitely super charming in this one. Super lovable, even though you know he's kind of like sort of unlikable in a way.
Yeah, yeah, but that
he's
makes
great,
like
man.
More.
He's just like totally, like he's like, you know, they're you know, he's spoiling his grandkids, you know, as you would expect. He's like feeding them chocolate for dinner type shit going on. You know what I mean? Like, it's what you want to see.
Well, yeah, you kind of also,
it's what you want to believe would happen.
You also kind of get the sense that, you know, and it's also like tied into this whole like why he's probably pushing for them to go in this little, you know, spy adventure so much. It's like, you kind of get the sense that he was a bigger piece of shit back in the day. And it seems like they kind of go into that a little bit, but not as much as you'd think. And like, but like, it's kind of hinted at just because through his actions, like, you can kind of tell he's trying to make up for like not being there in the past, or like, you can tell he's probably projecting some of his suspicions on her husband because he was kind of a piece of shit back in the day too. So it's interesting to see that character kind of have to deal with those, basically deal with himself, you know?
All right. What's number four for you?
Number four for me is a little movie called Palm Springs.
Okay.
Did this make your list at all, or is this?
It did. It's higher up on my list.
Oh shit. Well, I guess we're punting then.
All right. Well, there you go. The first one. Do you want to go another one, which would be what, your third?
Yeah, sure. I can do that.
Okay. So what's your number three?
Your favorite movie of the year. I'm thinking of Ending Things. The, you know.
Oh, man.
Laugh
yeah,
a
well,
minute.
This is a
family film.
Ash is ready for a divorce, you know. If she has to see that again.
Yeah, man, I still have yet to meet someone in real life, like, not read a critic's review or whatever, meet anyone else on this fucking planet that did not, like, loathe this movie, but I loved it. I'm sorry, I can't help it. I like weird, depressing shit sometimes, especially Charlie Kaufman, and yeah, it might be like I was just like craving Charlie Kaufman project, and I had built this one up so long. I think I nagged the shit out of you for us to like read the book, and then like this movie kept getting delayed, so I think I ended up reading the book twice, and like I was not disappointed when I finally saw it, and I feel like all the homework we ended up doing before it kind of actually informed me a lot, so that the movie was less impenetrable than I think it probably would have been. Like that, because that's the thing that I feel like whenever I talk to anyone, everyone's like, there's so many things that were confusing about this. It's like fucking weird and kind of boring and just like up its own ass. And once again, I totally understand anyone that thinks that, and they're probably not wrong. But I yeah, like the thing I like the most about Charlie Kaufman stuff is his, as depressing as it is, like, I like his unflinching looks at things that are super depressing, and his like wallowing in it, like his unabashed wallowing in it. But he really taps into like these insecurities and fears and everything that always feel universal. And the thing that I really like that's more obvious is like the way he expresses that through this weird dream logic and just the surrealness. Like I love anything that's surreal, and like he always figures out good ways of basically kind of like taking the way people feel internally and like making them express themselves exteriorly, like in the world that they're living in. And yeah, so it's a good creepy weird movie. I don't recommend anyone watch it with anyone they love or care about. Just watch it alone by yourself with headphones on, because it's like it's any movie that anyone will enjoy watching together.
Yeah, as someone who watched it with my significant other, I can assure you, yeah, it's not a great date movie. But we read the book. It's one of our films in our series of we read the book and then we watch the movie and then we complain about how they fucked up the movie. You know what I mean? But this one, man, like we had read the book like a year before, because it was supposed to come out and just kept getting pushed back and back. So we had like, and I'm honestly thankful that I had a year to read the book, because I had to start and stop and start.
Yeah.
And the novel is interesting, but yeah, you definitely, I think with more insight, you can appreciate the movie and understand what's happening a little bit better. But yeah, like as a civilian control subject, like Ash had no idea.
Yeah, it's like any movie that requires you to go down a whole slew of Wikipedia rabbit holes and shit like that. Like, you know, like I said, it's like totally up to your own opinion if that like makes for a good piece of art or not. I would say, like, aside from all that stuff, I think the thing that really centers it are you know, I think the direction's very good, but I think the performances are fantastic too. Particularly Jesse Buckley is like fucking amazing. And I think like that helps a lot too, because I think even in parts where logic is failing, like it's purposely just being illogical because it's deep into dream territory or just weirdness. I feel like the emotional truth of their acting really does help center it. Like, so you can watch a scene and if a character is doing things that don't make sense and is kind of like almost playing two different characters or having two opposite emotions in the same scene, you're still getting understanding that in the moment because just the actors are just doing such a good job just knocking it out of the park consistently the whole movie. And, you know, for a movie that is literally 75% two people in a car talking, that is incredibly important and kind of a hard thing to do. So I got to give them kudos there.
Oh, there you go. I'll link our long review, which, yeah, that was spoilers, right? That probably. So if you're interested, yeah. You've seen the book and you kind of want to know, you know, how the book added to it, supplemented to it. Yeah, I'll go ahead and link it in the description.
Worth a listen.
All right, my number four, Sound of Metal, going back to Amazon again. Riz Ahmed, Olivia Cooke, and directed by Darius Marder, who also co-wrote, and I think he might have helped direct. I can't remember, but I know he co-wrote The Place Beyond the Pines with Derek Cianfrance, and he actually kind of stole the concept of Sound of Metal from Derek Cianfrance because he himself was kind of in a band with, I think, a friend or his wife, and actually had some of this, you know, he kind of started developing tinnitus and some hearing problems. And, you know, like Archer, you know what I mean? Sterling Archer will tell you all about that dreaded tinnitus, you know?
That totally.
It's a cruel mistress.
It does sound like a Cianfrance sort of plot now that you mentioned it, like just, you know, something terrible that two couples are going to have to grip with the whole movie or whatever.
Yep. So it's a cool kind of premise. It's like it's like Sleigh Bells or some of those weird small bands with two people. But Riz Ahmed and Olivia Cooke basically are a couple who are in a metal band together. And then quite suddenly, Riz Ahmed, who's the drummer, he starts having very intense hearing loss to the point where he goes from being kind of like functionally normal to I can barely hold a conversation, cannot hear words, you know, being spoken to him directly in his face and things like that. So, you know, Olivia Cooke obviously is concerned for his well-being. They kind of call their manager. Their manager hooks them up with this guy who's running kind of a center for recovering addicts and people who are deaf and trying to help them adjust and things like that, played by Paul Rachey. Like, I don't know how you pronounce him, but he's great in the film. He kind of runs the center, and Riz Ahmed is kind of resistant to the idea of having to learn sign language. He thinks he's just going to like, no, I'm not going to invest in trying to kind of change and adapt. I want to resist, and I want to, you know, regain what I lost. And the whole movie is kind of his journey of like kind of coming to grips with it. That like, man, you know, you kind of need to figure out, you know, that was phase one and this is phase two. And then the faster you kind of figure out how to adapt, the happier you will be and things like that. Because it's interesting. There's a lot of like actual deaf actors in it. Lauren Ridloff is kind of a children's teacher of, you know, she's kind of running a classroom with deaf children. She's going to be in the, you know, MCU coming up with being in the Eternals. She'll be, you know, the first deaf superhero.
That's awesome.
You know, they've got... they've got incredibly spooky Matthew Almeric, the crazy Frenchman who was like the villain in Quantum of Solace, and he was in like Diving Bell of the Butterfly. He plays Lou's father living in France and things like that. So he's kind of great in it, and he's mostly pretty much in the third act, but it's a cool little movie. You know, I was trying to look into it a little bit. Dakota Johnson and Matthias Schoenaerts were supposed to be the stars of it, and they kind of fell through. But I mean, that's about as good as you can get as your kind of like a backup cast, you know what I mean, with Riz Ahmed and Olivia Cooke. So kind of worked out, but You know, Rizmetti took 6 months to learn how to play the drums. He did not? American Sign Language.
Oh, my God.
Because drumming's got to be hard.
Yeah, I think I had checked this one out with my brother, too, like the first, I don't know, like 40 minutes of it. And so good, but it's just a little too close to home for us because, once again, he's had musician and had kind of a similar situation, kind of. You know, not nearly as bad, but like he had a hearing scare at one point, and it just definitely they seem like they do such a good job just with, like, you know, just the sound design of like putting you in Riz Ahmed's head the whole time, and you know, and just like the whole thing where it's like it really is like your livelihood, not only your livelihood but your passion and everything like that just suddenly could be gone like one day, and it sucks too because, like, you really do get the sense that this is a guy that's been through a lot and is like kind of finally starting to get his shit together, and then something like this comes along and fucks up your life, like, ugh, so brutal.
Yep, it's a great one. It's I would think it'd be a little bit of an Oscar darling, but maybe not. I don't know. I can't tell.
I could see it.
It's a great one.
Yeah, I could see it. Maybe at least for acting, like Riz Ahmed probably get an Oscar nod. I bet you. Nomination,
yeah,
not win.
I think so. Yeah. No, I don't think it's gonna win, but yeah. All right. What's your, what are you at? Number two now? Are we back at
Wait, three? Do you have to do two? Do you have to do two next, or do I do two?
What number are you
I'm
at
two next, so.
Okay, so I'm at three. So let me do, I gotta get number three here. My number three, I'm Your Woman. Going back to Amazon again.
Oh, yeah.
Marvelous Miss Maisel herself, with Rachel Brosnahan.
Oh, she's such a good actress.
Written by Julia Hart, who did Miss Stevens, Fast Color, and Stargirl, which I've never seen any of them. I've heard they're good, but I've not.
Keep hearing good things, but don't know even what they're about.
I'll commit to Fast Color at some point.
Yeah, me too.
That's always been on my list to check out. She's married to Jordan Horowitz, the producer. So he was the guy who famously ran out on stage and bitch slapped Warren Beatty and said, "No, you're wrong. Moonlight won, you idiot." That's him. Wow. So that is her husband, the director. So she comes from a very fun family. But it's great. This is watching like James Caan in Thief or Godfather or any of those kind of like hard-boiled like gangster movies of the 1970s, like from the female's perspective, like the wife's perspective, like what are those family members, what would they do in some sort of weird crazy fallout, you know, of the Godfather or whatever. And so that's kind of what she set out to do when she kind of wrote this and everything like that. But it's great. Rachel Brosnahan plays the wife of a criminal who is kind of like an upper middle class gangster. This is, you know, set in the 70s on the East Coast. I want to say Philly. At least parts of it are in Philly.
Okay.
And it's great. It looks great. It feels great. There's good action. It's tense at times. There's the baby element where there's Rachel Brosnahan's character is kind of just a wife of this gangster guy named Eddie. And one day he basically just comes home and hands her a baby. Says, "You always wanted a baby. Here's your baby."
Sweet.
And just, yeah. So and it's not like a newborn baby. It's got to be, I don't know, 4 or 5 months old. So like, where the hell did this baby come from? So she's just now a mother of a baby.
Wow.
And not too long thereafter, one of her associates, you know, he says, "Hey, I'm going to be working late tonight. You know, don't worry about me, blah, blah, blah," whatever. She's in bed. Baby's like, you know, next to her in a crib or something. And she hears like a frantic banging on the door. One of his associates is like, "Oh, shit, something happened. We got to get you out of here." You know, starts rooting through her closet. Knows where some like hidden cash is, you know.
Yeah,
basically puts
like
$200,000 in a duffel bag.
Right.
Yeah, he knows where to go or something. And she's freaking out, like, "What's going on? What's happening? Where's Eddie? What's going on?" And so he kind of hands her off to another guy. And you know, it's interesting because this guy who is now kind of a de facto bodyguard / handler, kind of whatever. Uh-huh. You know, he's a black guy,
go between
guy.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, sort of. You know, he's basically kind of trying to squirrel her away. He's played by Arinze Kane as Cal. And so there's kind of an interesting scene. They kind of, you know, they want to, you know, talk a little bit about what the black experience of being, you know, kind of in this time where they get pulled over because it's a black man riding in a car with a white woman. It's in the 70s, but it's like still there. This cop is like, what's going on here? Like, how is this happening?
Right.
She's, you know, trying to explain it and everything. Obviously, kinda has to make something up.
So, and they still have the baby this whole time. Is this baby?
You know,
is it part of it?
And so,
is it like they bring the baby with them as they're hiding her or whatever?
Oh yeah.
Oh Jesus.
Oh yeah. they didn't leave the baby. But yeah, the baby is a big part of the whole movie. So, you know, the director was, you know, and Rachel Brosnahan, they kind of talked about how, you know, depending on how the baby, there were two babies. They're just twin babies. I think that's what you have to do. So the babies would only work 4 hours a day. Oh, and then, you know, this scene called for the baby to be asleep, but didn't want to do it. And then this scene needed the baby to be a little more animated than wouldn't do it. So like, it just created this whole weird dynamic of, shifting the tone of scenes, oftentimes based on the whims of a baby.
Baby's going to be awake in this scene. Guess what? Got to roll with it.
shake the baby. You know what I mean? But you know, but they rewrote some scenes, I think, because one of the babies was so asleep that everyone on set was like, "Don't wake the fucking baby!" Like, you know what I mean? Like, just roll with it. Like, now the scene is about the baby being asleep, and the scene is about keeping the baby asleep in a car.
That's so cool because I mean, just having—I feel like that's why people love to throw babies in movies. A lot of times, you have this tension just because you can sense what a pain in the ass it was probably to get the baby to work in the scenes or whatever you have concocted. It's like, if you have a long take and like somebody's holding a baby, like you're almost like kind of like constantly looking over at the baby, like, oh, or is the baby going to blow the take or whatever. So that definitely deserves some kudos for sure.
It was so weird listening to, was it Rachel Brosnahan or the director? I was listening to some interviews and she's like, the babies were about a month old when I met them. And, you know, but and I'm like, I don't want to cast judgment on you, but like, you have to be a complete psychopath to have like a 1 month old baby and be like, how can I get these babies in a movie?
It is crazy, man. I've definitely been on, I remember working on a commercial where like they needed a shot of a super cute baby. And they decided like on the day that the baby wasn't cute enough or something happened where like the baby fell through or something like that. So they literally called somebody up that day and it was like the same sort of thing. Like this is like a newborn baby, like less than half a year old. And like, I think they drove 3 hours to get to the set or something like that. And I'll be goddamned if when the baby showed up, it wasn't one of the cutest babies I ever saw. So I guess some parents.
So the new replacement baby was cuter that.
I think
so. They got what? How do they?
I think I think the other baby was older, and I think it. I'm trying to remember if it like was like the other baby didn't even make it to set. Like I don't think it was like the baby couldn't make it to set, but I think they decided they didn't want to go with that baby before the baby arrived on set. So it was one of those things where it was like a last minute decision by some muckety muck on the day. So there still had to be this big scramble, but at least they didn't drag this poor baby to set before they asked them to leave. But it was also like, you had these other parents who had this like, like 4 or 5 month old baby that they had to drive 3 hours just to get to set to do film for, you know, half an hour. But that's what comes with the game.
Baby get paid scale though?
No, I'm pretty sure the baby got paid, you know, decently, you know. I'm sure it's just got all the pacifiers it could possibly want for a while. But yeah, man, it's crazy. Like, I think it's just like some people know if you get in that game young, man, like, you know, there is, I feel like it attracts the best and worst people. So you either get people that are very smart and very cool, or just the absolute scum of humanity. And it often like doesn't go in between as much. It's just tends to be like one end or the other. So it's hard to say, but it is definitely interesting. But yeah, doing that in an indie movie, I feel like a commercial is one thing, but an indie movie, like doing that for months, must be rough.
Yeah, it sounds like it. All right, what are we on? Number two for you? Are we going
Back? Okay, yeah, so I think it's back to me. Oh, and yeah, my number two is this little movie about a cow, the first cow. I'm talking, of course, about First Cow, the masterpiece, dare I say, by Kelly Reichardt. I guess that's how you pronounce it. Yeah, this is a great little movie. I feel like, you know, I've been like seeing it pop up on a lot of best of lists now, but it was basically like I had heard about this movie. I think it came out like right at the start of the pandemic. And, you know, just by the title alone, I like really was like, this probably isn't for me. I've heard of Kelly Reichardt before. Like I know Miller's Cross was it Meek's Cutoff and like Lucy and Wendy and Lucy. And like she has some like movies. I think I've seen parts of Wendy and Lucy and I thought that was really good. And I've heard of her other movies, but I've never really like seen enough of her stuff to get a good grip on her. But I was like very impressed with this film. It's, another movie, it's kind of hard to describe. It really helps if you just see it. The best way I can describe it, I think, is like cuddly Revenant, because it's, you know, like set firmly in that frontier day, you know, I don't know, like 1700s, something like that. 1800s, I guess. And it's like, I think it starts out like our main character is a cook. I think his name is Cookie. Yeah, his name is Cookie. And he seems to be this kind of like shy, sensitive guy who's like stuck with some fur traders, and he's gone to Washington to go like make his, you know, it's like the gold rush, so everyone's trying to make their fortune. And then along the way he meets this Chinese immigrant guy by the name of King Lu, and then the whole movie is basically about like they kind of form a little friendship. They figure out, like, basically King Lu is like kind of like the enterprising businessman. Like he's like the guy that's like, oh hey, you know, we can, he's always got a vision. And then this cookie guy is like a cook who's actually got some really good ideas about cooking. And after talking a little bit, they're like, oh hey, you know, like this rich dude downtown just got the first cow in the territory, let's you know, maybe we can cook some cakes by stealing this cow's milk. And I know that plot description sounds like the most boring thing ever, but it's so, like, you get weirdly invested in it. And it's weird because, kind of have to give it 20 minutes, it opens very strangely. Like, I can't really go into why, but, like, you know, opening scene, you're like, what the fuck did I put in the right movie? And what does this have to do with anything? And but I like that they put this scene there because it kind of gives this whole movie a sense of tension that would not be there otherwise. And it, so, yeah, the whole movie is like kind of this weird balance between like this really sweet, you know, very like just sense of place and sense of people, like just really unique little scenes, but also kind of the sense of like, oh, it's the frontier and anything can kill you. So you're just like worried for these two people that are trying to like survive in this like harsh, shitty world or whatever. So yeah, it's hard to describe, but it's very, very sweet. And it's kind of like a story of America too, because it's got this whole like, you know, entrepreneurship baked in with stealing from other people thing. Yeah, it's a really cool movie, and I liked, like, it's kind of got this heart of like friendship and human companionship and everything like that, and I think that's a cool message to have. So I highly recommend it.
Bonding through thievery and whatnot, you know?
yeah you know, it's weird. It's definitely like their crime is so innocent, like it doesn't even like register as a crime kind of thing. Yeah, it's mm-hmm. really good. And it's also like a movie that's like feel like you could like, it's a great example of like what you can do on a low budget in terms of period pieces and everything.
Just one cow, right?
Just one cow. The cow is like literally the effect shot. I think there's a scene where like there's some scene where like Cookie's sitting at a bar and some big burly guy comes in and gets into a bar fight, and he's got a baby and he's like, here, watch my baby. And that, I think that's the closest thing to like an action scene in the movie or whatever. But I'm telling you, just throw it on. It'll be on Amazon or something sometime soon. It's like worth watching. Just give it like a half an hour and see where it goes. It's very cool. I like it a lot.
All right. All right. So we're back We're at number two for me, which is Palm Springs.
Hell yeah.
So this is this the first film that is on both of our lists so far?
Yeah. I think this is the only one I punted. Right. So, I'm glad that this made your list too. Cause I remember we did a review on this one too, right?
We did a longer review. It's, you know, the classic kind of time loop style, the added element being kind of adding an additional person that is experiencing your time loop as well. So that's, you know, the basic plot, if you haven't seen it, but it's, you know, it's on Hulu if you want to give it a shot. It's basically Adam Sandberg is trapped in an infinite time loop, like Groundhog's Day, but he's at his girlfriend's friend's wedding in Palm Springs. So he's surrounded by people that he doesn't really know, doesn't really care about. It's not a great time loop to be trapped in. You know what I mean? Yeah. He's been there for years and years and years. And then one day he, you know, has a run in with another guest who is the bride's sister, and she unfortunately kind of stumbles into this weird mystical kind of cave thing, which then initiates her as kind of joining in on his same time loop. So they are now trapped together, along with a third individual in this infinite time loop that they are kind of all conscious of together. You know what I mean? So she's not in one, and then he's in one. Like, they all wake up and they remember what happened in yesterday's loop. As soon as you fall asleep, you wake up again in the same thing, and then they can discuss what's happening. So it's serialized in that capacity. Yeah. So it's kind of interesting as they run the gamut of, it's like, is it if Bill Murray in Groundhog's Day had a mentor,
exactly,
kind of teaching you the ropes of being trapped in an infinite hell loop.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing because it's like, I know there's been like a slew of, you know, Groundhog Day-esque genre movies. It's like Groundhog Day plus blank. But, you keep on thinking you'll get tired of that premise, but who'd have thought that just Groundhog Day with another person could be so engaging and just fit so perfectly with that, like, you know, romantic comedy kind of structure, because it, and also talk about a perfect quarantine movie. Like it really is grounded, I think, too, by like just how charismatic the cast is. Like, Andy Samberg, who I think is like, pretty much always great. And Christine, we always screw this up. Margoletti. Margoletti, something Italian. She's great. She's been working for years, and I'm really glad to see her get a nice big lead role. Like, you know, she was on How I Met Your Mother, and I think she's had like bit parts and things. Like, she's got a really small role in The Wolf of Wall Street and a few other things, but
she's kind of the first wife, right? She's like she's Leonardo DiCaprio's first wife. She ends up leaving
like 7 minutes of screen time or something, but she's, you know, she tends to do like a lot of like guest appearances on shows and everything, but she always, oh, and you know, she was on that Black Mirror episode with that was like Star Trek themed. You know what I'm talking about?
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
With Jesse Plemons and is she the woman in it?
Yeah, she's the main character.
She's the lead.
Yeah.
Why did I think it was? God, I thought it was the actress from Sex Education and True Blood.
God,
what's her name? You don't know who I'm talking about? They look very similar.
Dropping the ball on her name, but I know who you're talking about. And also I kind of shout out, I feel like because the two leads are so great, none of love getting shown at both, of course, J.K. Simmons, who is fan fucking tastic, and like, you know, of all the great J.K. Simmons scenes, I feel like this has the J.K. Simmons stuff that I love. But also the guy, whoever, I don't know the actress's name, but whoever is playing Andy Samberg's actual girlfriend in the movie, like, I just remembered, like, she is very good at playing, like, just the right amount of just ditzy kind of, like, fake superficial girlfriend in a way that's, like, kind of real. And she's not, like, just, she's not entirely just, like, an asshole. Like, she is, but, like, in a way that I would still believe that I could actually meet that person, if that makes sense.
She's just completely grating and horrible, kind of like, you know, emphasizing that this is a personal hell.
Yeah,
to be trapped kind of in this with this person.
And like
he wakes up next to her every day.
Well, that's like one of the things I liked the most about this is just the fact, like, when the movie starts, like, if you haven't seen the trailer, like, you don't realize this is a time loop movie for like the first 25 minutes or something like that. And, you just kind of think, oh, Andy Samberg's is just like this checked out piece of shit. And it's a good way to kind of like introduce, like, the fact that you don't realize the fact that you catch him already having been in this loop for who knows how long. And the fact that, like, you never really know, like, he could be in there for years, like years and years.
Yeah. Hundreds of 30 years, 50 years, 100 yeah. years. Yeah.
And then also the fact that the characters actually seem to do, at least as far as I could remember, like, actually do the things that you usually scream at the TV, like, for people to do when you watch movies, like, ah, oh, why doesn't this character do this or try this or whatever? Like, it feels like they come to those conclusions around the same time that the audience does, and it actually, you know, like, yeah, does a good job of kind of staying ahead or staying with the audience and making sure most of the stuff is motivated in the plot and the characters and such. But yeah, and on top of that, it's just fun. It was nice to have a movie that was like a good, fun, easy to watch film this year for sure.
Yeah. Oh, I agree. I didn't really know the premise when I went into it. I watched it with Ash. She didn't know the premise. We just heard, oh, you know, it's getting good reviews, whatever. I didn't really look into it. I just kind of threw it on and it was awesome. So definitely one of the best of the year. What is your number one film of the year?
Well, my number one, you know, if you've listened to any of our other ones before, this is probably not too shocking, but this movie that I liked the most was a little film called Swallow. The gross little indie character study film. The director, Carlo Mariabella Davis. Never seen any of their stuff.
Is he Italian or?
I want to say Spanish, but I honestly have not. I'm like literally pulling up the IMDb right now. I probably should have done research.
I would say Yugoslavian or something maybe. Yeah. I don't know. It's very like, it's a very pretty movie.
I think this is their first full feature. Like, I'm looking at their IMDb and it looks like they've done some shorts years ago, but you know, and I think the thing with this is, like, you know, so much of a movie experience is sometimes it's just like, you know, where your head is at when you see a film. And I think for me too, it's just like the unexpectedness. Like, this was a movie I think I had heard some things about, and you know, it sounded kind of interesting, but I just assumed it was going to be way more exploitation-y than it ended up being. I think I caught this on, somebody was doing like a movie party and threw it on as a double feature, and I just ended up falling in love with it. I think it's so well directed, and it's just so humane for a movie, and empathetic for a movie that you never thought it would have. And, you know, this is like the sort of condition that, like, I always associate it with, like, the, you know, shitty reality TV shows, like Weird Addiction.
I ate a pound of hair.
Yeah, you know, like all that stuff that's just,
I'm eating my couch cushion.
Yeah, chew on light bulbs or whatever. That's the thing, is the movie gets all the grossness it needs out of that by just kind of showing you the object, showing you the implications, maybe just like the hint of like a quick little shot of a little bit of blood on a toilet seat. It's just so, like, you know, I think I watched this back around when we were, you know, in our horror movie binge phase trying to find movies for October. And, you know, of all the movies I saw, this was the one that, like, hit me the most viscerally and, like, it made me gag the most, because it's just like, it's so, when you see, you'll never look at like push pins the same way, or paper clips and stuff.
I can't,
you
know? Yeah, dude. Thumbtacks and stuff. And I mean,
and it gets so much worse.
Just your junk drawer, you know?
But
yeah, no, this is,
yeah, it's just such a good movie, and such a great performance by I've never seen Haley Bennett in anything else, but she was fucking fantastic.
She was in Hillbilly Elegy.
Oh yeah, which was I have not seen, but I know.
Well, it's the most hated film in America. You know what I mean? So I'm not surprised you haven't seen it.
I mean, I'll get to
but,
it.
But she's good. She's good in that too. She's good. She's she's trying.
Yeah, it's a good little character study. Yeah, I would say I feel like all of these movies, if they're not on Amazon, will end up on Amazon soon. So if you see it, I you know, suggest you give it a watch, because I feel like it's a movie that the type of movie that you throw on because you're bored and then it just wins you over or whatever. Like I said, like that I see at 2 a.m. type of film. That's always my favorite type of film. So
I think is this an IFC?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Actually,
Studios film or something. I think it is IFC,
yeah,
right?
IFC Pictures or whatever they're called. Yeah, you're totally right. So yeah, good on them. And yeah, like I don't know. I felt a little weird putting it as the first, just because it's not the biggest, or you know, there's probably more grandiose movies to pick. But it's definitely the one that like stuck out the most in my head when I think about the 2020 movie season.
Yeah, I think I guess I'm only surprised because to me, like, I don't want to ever see anything of this movie ever again after seeing it. So I'm shocked that it would be in your like, oh, it was one of my favorite films of the year.
Oh,
like,
man.
Like when you suggested it to me, I just found it online and watched it. I did not Google. I didn't watch the trailer or anything. Good. I didn't know anything about it. And
I think
I'm
that's the best
just,
way to see
God.
It. Yeah, the trailer gives away too much, honestly. But yeah, but I'm so glad that you did, because I feel like that's the type of movie
me.
And yeah, same thing. Like I agree. I don't know. I probably would rewatch this again because I'm weird. But like it's all about that initial reaction. Like, you know, whatever. If you can get me to react that deeply on the first viewing, it will like stick in my mind forever. So, you know, granted, you don't want it to be, there's gotta be some artistry there and everything like that. But it's like one of those things where it's like, it's hard to tell. I guess I like also the random movies a little bit more, cause you can tell those feelings are true. You know, it's not like you kind of like, got sucked into the hype machine for a movie coming out for a while. Or it's not like, you know, like I'm thinking of Ending Things to come out for 2 years, so I'm probably a little bit more primed.
Zero
like
expectations.
Okay, this was a weird fucking movie that I almost feel, you know, there's a little bit of that in First Cow too, I think, like just describing it to people, I'm like, no, I know I sound like an asshole, but I swear it's good. But this especially, I feel like, feels like something pure. In this world of, you know, fakeness or whatever. So,
yep. Unnecessary bowel surgeries are the way of the future, my friend.
Yeah. That's the highlight. If there's anything that's more 2020, it's just a movie that makes you want to puke. Right.
So, I mean, oof. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, I agree. It's a great movie, but yeah. Oh, God. All right. My number one film of the year.
Doing the drum roll.
I appreciate it. The Wolf of Snow Hollow. I love this movie.
Very good and pick, man.
But I don't know how to describe this, but it's basically a werewolf cop thriller comedy horror movie played by, you know, Jim Cummings, who wrote it. He stars in it. He's the director. He did Thunder Road, which I still have not seen somehow. And it's great. It's like a little mountain town. I think they're in Utah.
Mm-hmm.
And there's it's a very sleepy town. I think they say, you know, there's a murder every 2 years or something in their community. So suddenly there's some very vicious, brutal murders. And, you know, people are debating, and even the cops trying to solve the crimes. Or is this a man? Is this an animal? Like, what's going on? You know, people think it's a werewolf. So it is a... It's a werewolf horror movie with all kinds of different kind of criminal elements of a great kind of detective movie in a way. Mm-hmm. Like it's kind of got like the tortured detective, the narrator of Fight Club was like trying to solve a crime. It's kind of got like that kind of feel in ways, you know, and Cummings is like a huge David Fincher fan. So he drew a lot of inspiration from like Zodiac and Mindhunter and how Fincher does detective work in movies. He really wanted to kind of help try to emulate that, but it's incompetent, very flawed, like emotionally and intellectually, people trying to solve these like goofy murders.
Yeah, it's like your country bumpkins, like, you know, kind of Fargo-esque types trying right. to deal with real grisly murders and everything.
Right. People are, you know, they're used to the occasional traffic ticket or, you know, calling for, you know, domestic disturbance or break up a bar fight at the tavern. They're not used to serial murder. So as they kind of try to figure that out, Ricky Lindholm is also in this from Garfunkel and Oates, I think, right? Mm-hmm. Is that what their band is called?
She's great. Yeah, I'm glad.
Yeah.
I feel like she got a good, you know, she shows up in a lot of things these days, but I feel like she tends to be like almost like background a lot. Like she's in Knives Out, but she gets like five lines or something. And it's nice that she.
When was she in Knives Out?
She's like, man, she's I totally missed somebody's that. Spouse in Knives Out, but she's in it so little you'd forget she's there. But she's a very, you know, whenever you give her chances to shine, especially as a comedic actress, she's like, she's really good. And I think this was a great, you know, that, you know, Margie Gunderson type of role is really, really a good spot for her. You know?
Yeah, there's a great scene where one of the local businesses is, you know, kind of put up a sign. They put, you know, kind of those classic like marquee with like letters that you would put up on a church or put up. And she's basically kind of like in a very nice, cutesy way, like threatening to like give this guy a ticket if he doesn't like for expired plates. If he doesn't like, there's little cute little parts of it that really play well to her character and things like that, but yeah, she's great in it. It's got Robert Forster in his final role before he passed, so the film is kind of dedicated to him after, you know, as the credits roll. But it's, you know, obviously number one on my list. It's funny, it's scary, I actually watched it a second time last night. I bought it on Amazon. It's $6 to buy it on Amazon, so I bought it, had Ash watch it. She was like, yeah, loved it. Like, that was great. It held my attention the whole time. Mm-hmm. Half the time I'm looking over and Ash is looking at cat videos on Instagram. You know what I mean? So
yeah, I mean, that is always she is the litmus test, I feel like, for
absolutely
normal people.
So if Ash approves of it, you know what I mean? It's you got something on your head. Go check it out. Again, like less said the better. The trailer sucks.
Yeah.
I don't know who cut their trailer. It doesn't serve the film well. It looks like a goofy like student film trailer.
You know, the movie seems like it kind of has to gain some momentum, and it's like, that's one of the best things about it is like so much of the stuff comes from the characters, but you kind of have to like establish who the characters are first, and then like when the plot starts getting really crazy, it starts gaining momentum and everything. But the characters are so good in this. Like Jim Cummings too is like such a good, like the fact that he can direct himself and kind of has such a sense of like non-ego to like, you know, he has some scenes where he really has to like kind of both bare his soul, but also you just look like a total dumbass sometimes too. So like that takes balls in a movie that's your project, you know?
Yeah. I was watching an interview with him, and you know, a lot of the subplot is Jim Cummings is kind of, he's dealing with, you know, trying to kind of live up to, you know, his father is the current sheriff, and he's trying to deal with living up to the assumption that he's just going to kind of take over, you know, hopefully when his dad kind of retires. And the pressures of that, plus the pressures of this murder, he's desperate to solve. He feels kind of tortured that these people are being killed in his community, and he's being blamed for the continued, you know, violence and killings and things like that. So, you know, he kind of, like, listening to an interview with him, he was talking about how this character is kind of going through a nervous breakdown, and that's how he felt, because he got a lot of studio pressure to actually, they filmed the entire movie, and then they were like, hey, you need to go back and do some more here and more there. And so he was saying that he had to write the scenes, some of the scenes that are in the trailer, some of the scenes where, you know, he's a recovering alcoholic. So he's in AA meetings and he's describing how his life feels like it's, you know, he's freaking out. And he basically was just saying like, that was my experience. I was writing scenes about how to explain how I'm freaking out. And that's what he was actually doing. So.
Wow. That's amazing.
Like he really put himself in that, and then you're the writer, you're the director, acting it, you know. So
and not to put too fine a point on it, I'm sure dealing with the whole Robert Forster situation too. Like, you know, they seem like they dealt with that very well and everything like that. But I can only imagine having, you know, a legendary actor pass away in the middle of you filming your film. That's just like the cherry on top of the shit sundae, you know?
Yeah. That can't help. And even Ash noticed that. She was like, well, that's kind of awkward that he just, like, what happened? Like, they just, and I was like, that's.
That was real life, baby.
He died.
Yeah.
I mean, that, you know, she was like, yeah, they didn't really gladly explain that, you know, this or that or whatever. And I'm like, yeah, he's just, that's, that really happened. Well, there you go.
Yeah. Super good pick there. I totally agree. This was a very unique movie and I'm totally, wanting to see what he's got, you know, in his mind next or whatever. But yeah, definitely check out Thunder Road too, because it's funny like how similar they aren't, like super similar, like they're kind of tonally similar. Like Thunder Road definitely isn't a horror movie or anything, but it's almost like Wolf of Snow Hollow could be a sequel to Thunder Road.
Mm-hmm.
just because
it's like a cousin or something, like, kind of related,
just because it's like Jim Cummings is this poor put upon cop character, like he has kind of similar scenes of just bearing his soul in front of people. So he's good at that. I'll definitely give him credit.
Well, he's great in it. Go check it out. Support small. It's $6 on Amazon. Just buy it. Don't even rent it. Just, you know, throw it on for people. See what they think. It's great. I don't know anyone that's been disappointed about it. It's been, you know, there's a ton of people with great reviews on it on YouTube. If you need further convincing. But what did we do? 19 movies?
Yeah, that's pretty.
How many we do?
Pretty good for us, I gotta say. Yeah,
usually it's 15 to like 18. I of course didn't have Hustlers on my list last year.
I should have put Hustlers on my list this year. Actually, Hustlers is my number one for this year and next year and all years going forward. Just so you know,
that
should be said. You know, that goes without saying.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it was just another banner year. We're looking forward to a lot of movies. A lot of movies were supposed to come out in 2020.
Oh, man, so many.
You're supposed to have James Bond. You were supposed to have Maverick. You were supposed to have Black Widow, I think. You were supposed to have Dune. You know, mm-hmm. I think 2021 will have it'll be a little bit of a bigger year. You know what I mean? You've got the...
It'll be super big. Are you kidding me? It's going to have 2 years worth of popcorn movies. It's all crowding for attention, but...
Are you excited?
So excited. Please give me all the Jared Leto I can stand.
Shirtless Jared Leto flipping over tables.
Oh my god.
It's pretty much all we're asking for. But you know, I don't know. You know, maybe we'll do a what are our worst movies? I mean, I can tell you right now, the worst movie I saw all year that was a real movie, because I've watched things on Tubi that are made by like homeless people. You know what I mean? So I watched like The Amazing Bulk and stuff like that. But actual movies with people, my top worst movie of the year got to be Spree. Did you see that?
No, you told me about it. I actually saw it because it's streaming on like Netflix now or one of the major streamers. Ugh. It's on there. And I probably would have given it a try had you not already told me how terrible it was.
I mean, it's horrible.
Yeah.
I was like, this is a real movie, huh? Like they thought this would be a real movie. It's got that kid from Stranger Things, and I mean, this is awful. This is worse than this makes New Mutants look like the fucking Last of the Mohicans or something.
Well, I mean, you notice like I'm immediately turned off. I feel like that's almost like a genre into itself. Like the scary social media genre, you know, like you remember Nerve came out a couple years ago and then they had The Circle, mm-hmm. or something like that. Yep. You know, like,
yep.
All those movies tend to be trash. So
absolutely.
That's why. And so like when they had like, oh, it's that plus found footage, I'm like, I'm probably out. I haven't seen a trailer for it. So who knows? Maybe one night when I'm drunk, I'll turn it on, but it just didn't really catch my attention.
Yeah, well, there you go. That's my number one worst movie of the year. What is your number one? If you have
me on the spot, I can't. I don't have anything interesting. It'll probably be like New Mutants or something. And even that's, you know,
yeah,
that's
just
boringly bad. You know, I wasn't really a fan of The Gentlemen. I feel like a lot of people will probably kind of see that when it comes on streaming and be like, oh, hey, this movie actually isn't too bad. I think I was just, at the time, kind of annoyed to I saw it in theaters under duress just because I kind of needed to kill some time, and not realizing that would be the last movie I see in theaters in 2020 or possibly ever. But I remember...
Yeah, we're never going back.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, but that would have been a movie I probably would have enjoyed a lot more had I caught on TV, because it's like, it's got some okay stuff in it. Like, it's probably a good movie to like have on in the background as you're like not paying attention and chime in for the cool parts. But for the most part, it just made me feel like, you know, Guy Ritchie's old and lost it, and yeah, it just sucks because I love a good British gangster caper, and you know, Guy Ritchie just feels like he hasn't had that in 20 years, so it made me a little sad. I've probably seen worse stuff, but that's of the real movies I saw. Oh, you know, I got one more too that maybe I need to give another shot sometime. But this was one. Have you heard of this movie, She Dies Tomorrow?
Yeah, I've heard of it. I'm trying to think. I saw it's on something.
It's
right?
On, it's Hulu, on Netflix. I think. Yeah, it's on one Hulu. Of the
okay.
Streams,
I've never. I didn't watch it. But yeah, it's horrible.
Yeah, it made a lot of the best of the list this year, so I gave it a shot. And there's another one where I was watching with my brother, and he's kind of like my Ash. He's my litmus test for like, you know, regular people being like, okay, this is fucking, this is terrible. And I gotta admit, it was seemed pretty pretentious. It's something about like, a girl has a like made up illness that makes her feel like convinced that she's going to die tomorrow, and it like spreads to other people like a plague. So it's just a whole movie of people gradually like becoming convinced that they're going to die, and it's just them sitting in a room whining kind of. And like, yeah, I wish I could bring Ross in to just talk about how much he hated this movie. So,
well, wouldn't you be like, you know, it's the, you know, masturbating on a crashing plane type situation, everyone just going wild and partying.
Yeah. But it's like,
it wouldn't be like sitting in a rocking chair, like freaking out.
Yeah. I think there's a little bit of that. We did not finish the movie. We kind of gave it like half an hour, and then we skipped to the end, and it kind of got the sense that there's a little bit of that, but it's a lot of like, it's clearly like one of those movies that's probably made by LA actors in LA just with their friends kind of thing. Like it's like set in a lot of apartments. So it's kind of like LA actor people whining about LA actor things. I don't know. Like I said, I only watched the first 30 minutes of the movie, so I can't give it a good gauge, and who knows, maybe I'd watch it some other time and like it, but that definitely stood out as our like what the fuck was this movie of recent memory.
It's been a year. There's been movies, you know, there's just too many to name. You know, we went through, you know, our favorites. Obviously there's just, you know, there was still stuff out there, you know what I mean? There was the Wonder Woman's, the Black Bears, the the Hunt, you know, there was Mank, you know, there was Hillbilly Elegy, which isn't as bad as everyone says. There was The Devil All the Time, you know, so there's other stuff out there, you know what I mean? But these were our favorites. You know, a little Waiting for the Barbarians, if you will. Mm-hmm, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I watched even The Buddy Games. You know what I mean? It stars Olivia Munn, Dax Shepard, Nick Swardson, and Josh Duhamel. So imagine how good that movie is.
I mean, this is one that I've not heard mention of, I've not seen a trailer of. I was unaware of its existence until you let me know just now. So
yeah. I mean, it's not bad. It's not great. It's just, it's dumb. You know, it's a good sit.
It's a good set. You just,
well, it's like, remember, yeah, it's there's gags that were done in American Pie.
Oh,
like in 1998.
And wait, are you telling
decided,
me?
Let's.
Does a pie get fucked in this movie? Because I'm all in. If
it's maybe it was the sequel I'm thinking of. No, it's not pie related. Yeah, so okay. there are pie scenes, oddly enough.
Okay.
Now that I think of it, there's a pie eating contest in the movie, but it's. I don't know, man. There's a lot of trash out there, but anyway.
Well, we appreciate you guys. Place. Yeah, yeah. We'll have plenty of trash to get through later on. You know, 2021 will be a year of trash for us.
We're gonna have to wade through the trash. You know what I mean? Yeah. We're having to step over a Mission Impossible and a Maverick.
Yeah.
To get to
the golden nuggets of
Buddy Games.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah, yeah. gotta go. You're the expert of finding the weird shit on Amazon Prime. So we're gonna have to find the next. The Beast Must Die or whatever the hell.
Oh yeah. And now with the advent of Tubi, you know, we're just our you know, the amount of incredible, shitty, not even B movies at our disposal. Oh, no.
This is C and D tier, my friend.
Oh, yeah.
What a time to be alive.
It's never been a better time, I'd argue. So 2020, it was it sure happened, you know what I mean?
I'm definitely ready for it to get the fuck out of here. So hopefully.
There you go. So at the stroke of midnight, everything will change, and it'll be great. Yeah. But we're wishing you guys the best in 2021. Obviously, the world, obviously, you know what I mean? We're hoping for better times, better things. Yeah. Can we get back into a movie theater? Can I have alcoholic milkshakes in an Alamo Draft House, perhaps? You know what I mean? As I scarf down some French fries.
Yeah, I'd love dream it. Dream big, man. Dream big. Maybe it'll come true.
You know? let's see. Fingers crossed. But thank you guys so much for sticking with us, listening to this thing. We appreciate it. We love doing this end of the year. It's stressful because we're trying to cram in as much as we can to kind of offer the best suggestions. Again, take them as you will. Don't really pay attention to the order. You know, these things are different depending on how you're feeling at them, you know, and things like that. But we appreciate it. Hopefully you guys find some of these interesting. Go check them out. They're all worth your time. We can't guarantee that you'll love them, but we hope that you'll give them a shot. A lot of them are smaller movies that aren't just going to – they're not going to pop out at you about a movie about a goddamn cow. You know what I mean?
I'm telling you, it's good.
A movie about a girl swallowing objects.
They're both good. They're both good. Just take our words for it. Our trusted exactly. opinions.
Just watch the movie. That's my final message of the year.
Yes, everyone else except us is lying to you. So just listen to us.
Absolutely. Especially Watch Mojo. That list was terrible.
Oh, yeah.
Not to call them out, but they're that might be the worst best movies of the year list thing that I've seen.
There's definitely
don't pay
a lot of people got some weird picks. It's funny seeing when everyone can kind of just find their own weird movies on streaming, like what some people gravitate towards. But you know, whatever. C'est la vie.
We're not gonna kink shame. Yeah,
I ain't yucking your yum. You know.
Well, there you go. But again, thank you guys so much. Give us a like, share, subscribe.
Please, we're begging
please.
You.
Just one like. Just one That's like. All we really
Click
need.
Click right there. The button's right like. There. Just please.
I'd take a please don't dislike.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? For our feelings about Rocky Balboa movies and things like that. You know what I mean? Please just, you know, if you can just come as you are and leave as you go kind of a thing. You know what I mean? Without kicking the table over. You know what I mean? And leaving us an upper decker. I'll take that. But if you could throw us a like, I'd really appreciate it. But yeah, thank you guys so much. We'll be back. And more movies in 2021. Possibly shows, possibly sports. Who knows? Depends on what the world will let us have.
Yes, the future is wide open. And hopefully, yes, public sporting events and entertainment would be nice.
Yeah, we had big plans to get Mr. Andrew Volpe to go do some correspondence at a XFL game. And the world conspired against us. The league folded and professional sports have basically shuttered. So
if that is not a sign, I don't know what is that I should not be. I think.
Well, there you go. Mr. Andrew Volpe doesn't. If you yell things like touchdown, he goes, baseball.
Yeah.
If you yell home run, he goes, football. Like, he doesn't know. So we were going to have a lot of great content, like sending him to horrible DC sporting events. But keep your fingers crossed. We're praying like hell that all that is going to shape out and return in time and get this poor gentleman that doesn't know anything about sports. I mean, pretty much nothing.
As close to nothing as you can get.
Yeah, pretty much nothing.
Yeah.
But we're going to get him, you know, love to get him down to center ice to watch some touchdowns in a Washington Capitals game or something. You know what I mean? So it'll be great.
Yay, sports ball.
Thank you guys so much. Yeah, exactly. Well, thank you guys so much as always. Happy New Year. Stay safe. Don't drink and drive. Please be careful out there. As someone who used to work in a bar.
Yeah.
I could tell you. But again, Happy New Year, guys. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. We'll catch you next time.
See you in 2021.